Hello everybody, they call me Muse and this is the first bits of Lunacid. First person dungeon crawler in the style of the old Kingsfield games, which I never played. And I've had a couple of hours of playing through it. But we're going to start a new game and show you what it's like. The art style's all a bit PS1. It's pretty cool. The moon is involved in some way, hence the title of the game. And the birds certainly seem to be involved as well, although it's not entirely clear how, from what I've played to date. Oh, and there's that thing.
Long ago, a great beast came from the sea and brought with it a poisonous fog that spread across the earth. Corrupting everything it reached, the poison fog slowly transformed the world and brought about a new age. Now, grounded by the poison sky and outnumbered by creatures, humankind became desperate and formed feudal kingdoms. Closed off from each other, they became paranoid and are on the brink of extinction. Those deemed undesirable, such as criminals or the ill, are cast out, banished into the depths of the Great Well, a pit of the diseased and undead. The Great Well is said to have but one door to the surface.
So there we go. It used to be like a regular everyday world with VHS tapes and things like that. But now it's got fallen back into a new dark age. There's polygons. It's textures. It's definitely got its own very distinct art style. I believe it was made by one person. We got a Klingon. We're going to need to deal with that. And that's how. And then we just flick the hand off into the depths. So I think that's us. Old One Hand McGee over here. But who are we? And here's where we get to choose who we are. So, we've got various names that we could enter, obviously. We've got various beauties. Which is a curious term, the avatars and whatnot. And then we've got classes and pronouns. So, let's see. I think I'm going to start as a fairly strong melee character, like maybe a knight. Low int, though, which is a shame. Who's got decent strength and decent int? Are there any of them? Seems like no is the answer, so we'll go with a knight. And I've got a specific character in mind, because seeing that the avatars are called Beauty, and seeing that you can add your own custom avatars, which is a thing that I know we can do, wouldn't it be handy if I had a cat called Beauty? And there he is. Yeah, he's one of the few that showed up after the old Elden Ring mega play began, so he didn't get to star in that, but he can have his own game instead, or at least the first bits of one. So we are going to play as old Boots over there. He's going to be a knight. And we're just going to jump on in. And we're in the Hollow Basin. So yeah, first person, as we said. I am playing it with a controller. I have actually recorded this video once prior to this, where I played with keyboard and mouse. But I also played it blind, and it turns out that's really not a good idea for this game. Because as you can see, this is an old school game. And part of that means it doesn't bloody tell you anything unless you've actually read the manual. So there is an in-game version of said manual, which you can read through, and it's got all the controls and the story and general guidance. But what I did was I just fumbled around for a couple of, well, for an hour. It didn't go very well at all, so I quit. And then I read the manual, and then I came back and played with a second character who was a lot more fun. So I thought, heck it, let's redo this video now that I've got a bit of knowledge, and I might be able to make the game look a little better. Just going back the way we came to just smash up some coffins. So you can hold down to charge up your attacks. And you can also attack flowers and things if you feel the need. So we've got health and mana on the left-hand side. Mana being purple, which is an unusual choice, to be sure. But not unheard of. And yeah, that's enough boshing of coffins, I think. On the right-hand side, you've got the charge button. Well, the charge bar. And when that's fully filled, you can do a charge attack instead of a regular. And then the button underneath that, or the bar underneath that, is the weapon XP bar. So the more you use a weapon, the more XP it gets. And when you get enough XP, you might be able to do something with it. So that's the plan for this video. We're going to play long enough to be able to do something with it. So we'll just save the game. We can't warp because we've got no other locations available to us at this point in time. And so let's crack on and find some enemies. The other character I've really had a decent go with is more of a mage, so it'd be interesting to have to rely purely on the old blades. Might get some currency from these pots if we're lucky. Or some items. There's some ashes. There's a sort of alchemy system where you can gather up items and mix them up to make potions and whatnot. Can't jump up there because we haven't got the stats for it. I've learned in the past that we also can't drop down there because we'll just die. So, which way should we go? Let's go this way. We might meet our first enemy just around here. It's a snail. And we've chopped its head off with a single blow because we're great. So it definitely seems like hitting different body parts of enemies has different effects. Like with the snails, it's fairly obvious. If you hit the shell, nothing happens. If you hit the body, they take damage. And we got the Temple of Silence to the right and the Hollow Basin to the left. But the temple is locked. So I guess we'll have to explore the basin a little bit. It's got good atmosphere, this game. It's gloomy and a little bit creepy. The music's fairly minimalist, but it does the job. Another dude down. There's another one in there, but there's also one over here, so let's get this one. Because, yeah, leveling up weapon XP is the name of the game. We took a blow there. I'm not sure if these guys can actually hit you when they are headless. I've certainly not been hit by one on my brief dabbles with the game to date. Now, what about you, friend? Your head's off too? Good. The crosshairs seem a little iffy at times. It's like it's a very faint crosshair. You can just about see it in the middle of the screen. It might be a bit clearer if I move to different textures, but yeah, it's very faint crosshair. So sometimes I seem to miss attacks when I'm not sure I was supposed to miss them and whatnot. But either way, another crit. Yeah, and I should probably just be aiming a little higher than I think I should be. And now we've got a big snail. This is the milk snail. So we're gonna do the old dodge in, dodge out. It's gonna try and attack us, of course. Come back here. Fight me like a man. Oh, it fired at me. Never seen that before. And now it's retreated into its shell. So let's just poke our sword right up in there. And wow, first try, we got the ice sickle. So let's have a look at our weapons. We've got the replica sword already. We could put the ice sickle in our second slot if we wanted. It does more damage. It's a curved icy blade, and it does ice damage rather than physical. You can also guard with your weapons, which we've not really been doing to date. But look at that. Ooh, it's quick. I suppose we should also, just in case, put our healing potions on our quick bar. So you press left and right on the D-pad to switch between items, and up on the D-pad to use them. The main reason I switched to controller is because magic users have extra attacks they can do with magic spells that they cast. There's a magic mana potion right now. We'll go ahead and pop that on. And there you go, see, we can switch between them. And yeah, the controls are a little fiddly for magic spells. So you move them with WASD and D, but then it's like C and V on the keyboard, I think, are the keys that you use to actually use your magic. So yeah, kind of awkward. These guys are pretty chill. These guys don't want to attack us. And if we die, we'll get sent back to that glowing crystal we saw at the start. So I don't really want to attack anything at this moment in time. Just in case. We're very fragile because it's early game. My first character that I played was a thief who starts at level 5 with 5 in all of their stats. And I think they're supposed to be like the canon character, but they are so weak. I was just either dying or running past enemies. Those were my two options. So yeah, I'm happy to continue on this sturdier boy for now. I guess I could fight one of these just to see how we get on. Yeah, we didn't take too much damage. I was like dying in a couple of hits on the thief. But yeah, you can take down a shulker with this ice sickle. You'll notice it doesn't have XP though. It doesn't have an XP bar, unlike our replica sword. So the replica sword can be leveled up, but the ice sickle just is what it is. But I gather it's important to have different elemental types available to you, because it's kind of necessary. We can grab ourselves a magic ring, and now we've got access to a spell. We've got Flame Spear, so I'm going to pop that on slot 1. We can now throw fireballs at our enemies. Oop, did I not pop it on properly? There we go. So you can hold down a bumper button, and when it builds up to max, you can hurl a spell, and it will use mana, which generally only gets regenerated when you get back to one of those crystals. So you can't just magic your way through everything, it seems, because there's no natural mana regeneration. And down here we should find ourselves back at that crystal. And here's a friend who wasn't here earlier, so we will save. Can we level up? Let's have a look. Yeah, we've got 158% XP, which means we've got enough for basically a level and a half. It's not very clear. It doesn't tell you, oh, you've got enough for a level now. You just have to try and level up, because it's just generally a bit silly like that. Wait, do we only have five in everything? Did I actually not pick a knight? Did I pick a thief? I did. I ended up picking a thief instead of a knight. What a bloody idiot. So, I am playing the same character that I was getting my ass kicked on previously. Except this time I just seem to be doing a bit better. I guess just because I've learned more of the game. So, scratch some of what I'd previously said, because it was stupid and I'm a very silly man. Now, we could focus a stat. I don't know what's best. Let's get two strengths, because it gets max health and melee weapon damage. There is a dex stat which boosts ranged weapons, but I haven't found any ranged weapons yet, but we have found a spell, so let's also get int, because I want to be a sort of hybrid character. Oh, have we got enough for a second level? Let's see. Although I would also like speed to be coming up with the rest, just because I do want to be able to move around the dungeon faster. So, let's have a look. We are only level 6, so I guess we've just got 6 skill points available to spend there. Which is fair enough, and we've got 14 silver. Now, let's chat to our little anime friend over here. Hello, Demi. We are lost. Yep, this is Hollow Basin. Jolly good. And it's safe, but Wings Rest is also safe. And Demi can take us there, so off we go. And here we are, we found our hub. And we've activated our warp crystal, so now we can bounce between two areas. Also, we've got pumpkins because it's nearly Halloween. Hello, Demi. I like that. Last time she tried the spell, it only worked about halfway, so it's like, did the person get halfway to Wings Rest, or did half of the person get all the way to Wings Rest? So yeah, there were a sect of holy monks. They got thrown into the Great Well for some sort of blasphemy, and they made a temple down here. And then yeah, just general gubbins about using crystals to get back out. And some candy, because it's delicious. Hello. Cheryl the Crow. I've just realised that's just a reference to Cheryl Crow, isn't it? For some reason. Well, either way, she's a shopkeep. Yep. We're going to spend some money. Now, things like the rapier and the steel needle sound fun. Crossbows definitely sound fun, but we can't afford any of that gubbins for now. What we can afford though is an enchanted key which gets through the enchanted gates. So let's purchase that. And that will allow us into the temple that we had seen previously. Here's the moon. It cried to us in our time of need. And here's a thing that I didn't know what to do with when I first came here, because I hadn't read the manual yet. But now I know that you can upgrade weapons at it. It's a blacksmith's sort of thing. As it says on there, I think it says Roberto Hephaestus. And we all know who Hephaestus is, don't we? Swash. Now, let's have a chat with old Clive. Well, he's not really called Clive. But yeah, he has been down here for a while. He's a skeleton. The rest of him's gone. But his bones are good. And he's given us some free health vials. Lovely. And then we have our alchemist friend, Etna. So she will let us mix and match various materials that we can pick up. So we've already got some recipes unlocked, such as health vial, mana vial, and so forth. And then there are quite a few that we don't know, but we could mix and match materials to try and find them out. But for now, we haven't really got any materials, so let's head back. Let's leave this lovely hub music behind and go into the Temple of Silence. On my first playthrough, I got absolutely bodied in the Temple of Silence. As soon as I found an enemy, it was just a case of, well, I'm boned. But on my second playthrough, I just did the old Dark Souls thing and just ran past everyone and eventually found my way to another area where I was able to do just a little bit better. But what we're going to do this time is we're going to actually upgrade the sword and get a nice new one. And that might allow us to hold our own in the temple. Maybe. Now this bit's a bit fiddly. We have to put the enchanted key on our equip bar. And then we have to select it and use it. I guess it works as like a little tutorial for showing you how to use items in case you've not already used a health file or anything. Now we make our way down, down, down. We find a torch, which is another weapon. I'm inclined to put it on instead of this icicle. And you'll notice it also has an XP bar. It can be upgraded into a superior torch. Quite a long way down. Don't think there's any real reason to go back to the upper area. But there might be other items which I'm yet to see. But we can always walk back there later, if I need to. Now. We arrive at the temple. It's all a bit creepy down here. But there's also stuff. We like that. Maybe I should stick to the sword for now. It makes the game darker, obviously. But we do want to get it leveled up before I end this video. Although, goddamn, it makes the game darker. So, yeah, in the interest of YouTube, we'll stick to the torch for now. Until we get somewhere a bit lighter. But here's a lad. He's got no face. It's all very spooky. There are actual enemies down here, though. Although they're way away, I think. It's kind of like a maze-like design. You've got like various blocked-off routes, and then they'll open up down the line. You've got this creepy music on the go. Now, is this way blocked off for now? Maybe. Oh no, there's a flight of stairs up, so that's good. We got a book. So we can learn from here that the great prophet Abdul has found a way out. People are tethered here physically, but their minds can be extracted through enlightenment. So Abdul thinks he's technically found a way to get free. There's a ritual dagger, which is another weapon we could use. It's fast, but not big damage. And it doesn't have any sort of upgrade path. Now down this way we have some lads around some sort of mysterious statue. And we've got another spell, Lithomancy. What say you, friend? Hunger is to live, to consume is to die. So Lithomancy is a forbidden blood magic that gives life to the inanimate. Unable to comprehend existence, the objects only scream. It was created by the mad wizard Abdul before his exile. It's unknown what the purpose of the spell was. So we could make rocks scream. Very much seems like a puzzle spell, but I don't know what the solution is or where it should be used as a solution. So we're just going to crack on. And this is about the point I got to the first time I played. I kept going that way and I ran into a mummy and it bothered me. But then the second time I played off camera, I came this way instead. And there was another mummy. But I just said, heck it, I can't kill these things, they're just too strong. So I'm just going to run away. And then I found some more mummies. And so I carried on running. Until I found myself in here. And went down this path. So that's all what we're going to do now. This side room. I think this is a room we could have been in earlier. but as we've made it down this far, yeah, this was right near the start, and that's the way out. But because we've made it this far, the doors sort of automatically open, it seems. So, on we go. Can we switch back to sword? Kinda. It's not too dark in this corridor. And we should probably try and fight at least one of these mummies so I can show you why I've just been running past the buggers. Is that one that's chasing us? That's probably a good bet, actually, that one. Because I'd quite like to fight two, so I can use blade on one and magic on the other. Now, you're alive, aren't you? Yeah. Look how little damage that's doing. It's got lunge attacks as well. These, there we go. So yeah, it deals good damage to us. But, we've taken off its head. I feel like with the mummies, that's not going to slow them down too much, unlike the snails. But there we go, we killed a mummy, and we got 10 currency for it. And that cost us nearly half our health. So it seems in the early game, at least, until you've leveled up a bit, probably not worth fighting everyone that you see. Now, this lad has got a stone club, which is another weapon we could potentially use down the line. And then we find ourselves near a door. Are there any other mummies just back here a bit? This kind of leads back to that room that we just went into. Yeah, so it's two routes that loop around to the same spot. There seems to be a fair amount of that in the design from the little I've seen. But I have seen the next area, so we'll just pop into there, do what we need to get our sword leveled up a bit more, and then maybe we'll upgrade it and call it a day. I'm definitely excited to play more of this game, all told. I'm having fun with it. And that's how we get lotus seed pods. We slash up plants. Plus they give us weapon XP. Now we find ourselves at a crossroads of sorts. The way on is blocked, but we've got left and right. And this tells us that the lower passage is to the left, but the rest area is to the right. So maybe we'll head down there and break some more pots on the way. Although actually we should probably come back this way after we've fought another enemy. So let's head down this way and see what enemies we have around. And we've got slimes. And as you might imagine, our blade doesn't do a lot to the slimes. But you might notice as well that our weapon XP bar has just lit up. It's now a nice light blue, which means our weapon is ready for an upgrade. And now we set a slime on fire. And they don't like that. So, although there's no official tutorials for the game, this is a good way of showing you that, yeah, different enemies have different levels of resistance to things, and there are ways of beating them that might be easier than others. So I'm definitely looking forward to playing more of this and exploring some more. Could also fight the rats. Don't know if there's any purpose to it. I assume not, but who can say? What I can say is that we found another crystal, and so we can bob back to Wings Rest. We've probably got more level ups, actually. Yeah, 3 points left, so we've leveled up once. And we got 3 points. So, more strength, but more in. I might keep a balance between the two. Now we're back at the hub. And if we head over to our Enchanter's Oil, we might be able to do something over here. So the blade we've currently got, the replica sword. Damage 7, speed 25, reach 3. Let's see what happens if we use the oil to enhance our weapon. We've now got the heritage sword. Damage 21, speed 33, reach 3. A steel longsword, typically given to the castle guard. Though the castle fell long ago, these swords remain as testament to the quality of the royal armoury and have been passed down for generations. now we can probably slash things up good and proper. But maybe we'll go back and bite one of those mummies again and just see how that goes. I'm not sure how large this game is. I think there might be about 10 different warp points or thereabouts. And yeah, it's definitely going to be fun to keep strolling through and explore, I feel. Learning as we go. The fact that I've got back to this point this quickly compared to my first playthrough is testament to the, like the FromSoft games, like Dark Souls and such, and possibly like Kingsfield, which I've never played, it does seem as though knowledge will just make things much easier for you. Oh, that's a good shot. Yeah, these mummies are definitely more manageable now that we've got a cool sharp blade. So we do like that. Oh yes, we do. Maybe I'll find another one and throw some fire magic at it. Yeah, here's a couple. And you might notice that when they burn, they don't burn for very long, because they've got a much higher resistance, I presume, than the slimes. Although this one's burning quite well. I've had some before where they've just pretty much gone out almost immediately, because I think undead in this game do have a high resistance stat. But yeah, we could definitely survive around here, I think, now with this posh new blade. And I certainly intend to, because I'm going to play more of this and have a jolly good time. And if you like what you've seen, it's available now on Steam. Feel free to give it a go. I would suggest read the manual first, though, because if you're the sort of player who likes to just go for 2 hours first, just to see if they like it, you don't want to spend those 2 hours having not read the manual, because you won't have as much fun as otherwise. And on that note from the early 2000s of Read the Bleeding Manual, I'd like to thank you all for watching, and I will see you next time. Ooh, we've taken his arm off. Doesn't like that. See you later, friends.